Well, we're going to start at verse 15 of chapter 21 of Acts. And you may recall, we looked last week at the fact that Paul is on his way back to Jerusalem, even though on his stops along the way, he is continually told that trouble awaits him in Jerusalem. Arrest, imprisonment, actually chains are his future. And yet, he's going forward. He is willing to die for the Lord if need be, but he feels like he must go to Jerusalem. And so that's where we're picking up. This is at the very end of what is known as Paul's third missionary journey. The book of Acts has three different missionary journeys of Paul with beginning and endings. So now we come to the end of the third one. And so at verse 15, and remember when we read we, that's because Luke is traveling with Paul throughout much of Acts. And when you see we, you know that's an example when Luke is there with him. After those days, we packed and went up to Jerusalem. Also, some of the disciples from Caesarea went with us and brought with them a certain Mnason of Cyprus, an early disciple with whom we were to lodge. Early disciple means he probably was one of the earliest to believe on Jesus Christ there. And when we had come to Jerusalem, the brethren received us gladly. On the following day, Paul went in with us to James, and all the elders were present. When he had greeted them, he told in detail those things which God had done among the Gentiles through his ministry. At this point, James is the head of the church in Jerusalem. In the very earliest days, Peter was clearly the leader, but that now has moved over to James. Now, because James is a fairly common word, including in our Bibles, this James that we just saw mentioned here, that Paul is meeting with along with the elders in Jerusalem, is the same James that wrote the book of James in our New Testament. He is what we would call the half-brother of Jesus, because obviously, though they shared the same mother through Mary, Jesus had no earthly biological father, as we know. So that's why I say half-brother. But this is not the James that was the brother of John the Apostle, John who wrote the Gospel of John, Revelation, and all that. Because that particular James, who was one of the original 12, if you recall, Peter, James, John, Andrew, you know, Thomas, all those guys, that James has already died. He was one of the earliest martyrs in the church. Stephen was the first martyr, but James was shortly thereafter. So, just to keep the Jameses straight, when Jesus is walking the earth in the Gospels and we read about a James that is with him, the brother of John, that's not this guy, but that one is the one who died. Now we're dealing with James, Jesus's part of his family. Again, half-brother, and he's become the leader of the church in Jerusalem. And it's not that we just see this in chapter 21 here, but actually way back in chapter 15, we had the first church council, which took place at Jerusalem, when they were trying to deal with this issue. What are we going to do about these Gentiles who are becoming believers? What relationship to the law of Moses do these guys have? And they dealt with that. That's going to be touched on here. That's why I reference it. So, continuing on. Paul's giving them a recap, telling them all that he's done among the Gentiles on this third missionary journey. And verse 20, when they heard it, they glorified the Lord. And they said to him, you see, brother, how many myriads of Jews there are who have believed. There's a lot of believers in Jesus Christ in Jerusalem at this point. The church is large, they're saying. And they all are zealous for the law. But they've been informed about you that you teach all the Jews who are among the Gentiles to forsake Moses, saying that they ought not to circumcise their children, nor to walk according to the customs. What then? The assembly must certainly meet, for they will hear that you have come. Now, that's not true. We don't read anywhere that Paul was telling the Jews, hey, stop being Jewish. Don't circumcise your kids. Don't worry about living like you have your whole life, culturally speaking, as a Jew. We don't see Paul doing that. The issue was with the Gentiles who were becoming believers in Jesus Christ, and that the Gentiles didn't have to somehow get circumcised, for example, in order to really be saved or to stay saved or however you want to put it. They weren't under that obligation. And we won't repeat everything we said, but the whole focus of what Jesus did for us on the cross is that we receive a free gift, a gift of God's grace, because Jesus did all the work. He lived the perfect life, the Son of God who came to this earth, obeyed every commandment of the Father, lived perfectly, and therefore died unjustly. Death had no claim on Jesus. The wages of sin is death, but Jesus knew no sin. And yet, when he died, he did so as a substitute for you and for me and for all of the world. He died for the sins of the world, and he conquered the grave on the third day, rising again. And the good news is that if we will believe that all of our sins, all of the wrongs we've done against God in our life, or ever may still do against God in our life, if we will simply believe that when Jesus died, he died for all those sins, and we ask him to forgive us, we'll be forgiven. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses a man from every sin. And there's nothing on our part that we add to that. We don't add, and make sure you go to church every Sunday, and make sure you tithe, and make sure you pray, and make sure. Those are important things in following Christ, obviously. Serving, worshiping, giving, praying, Bible reading, you know, obviously. But they don't add to our salvation one bit. And of course, in the early church, which began all Jewish people, the early church began Jewish, just like Jesus is Jewish, the disciples are Jewish. So their big issue was they've lived their whole lives. In fact, for centuries, the Jewish people had lived with the obedience to the law of Moses. Now, often they disobeyed the law, don't get me wrong, but the idea is we this is our life, this is our culture, this is our heritage, and there's nothing about following Jesus Christ that says you give up your culture and your traditions and all that, as long as you understand that none of those things get you right with God. And so Paul didn't tell the Jews to stop being Jewish in effect, but as the Gentiles became believers in Jesus Christ as well, which the early church, the Jews, I mean, they were shocked that God had that in mind, but he did. And we saw when Peter went and shared the gospel with the first Gentile that was born again, that guy Cornelius, and all of the details that God did to make that come together so that there was no doubt to the Jews that, wow, the Gentiles are part of this plan also. So just like the Jews aren't required to stop being Jewish in the sense of tradition and culture and so forth, on the other hand, the Gentiles are not required to, in effect, become Jewish and put themselves under the law. No. And so that was what the big Council of Jerusalem was all about in the 15th chapter of Acts. Now, the bottom line is this. And we saw in the very early days of the church, when it was all Jewish, that some of the Jews that were believers in Jesus Christ were very influenced by Greek culture and society. Remember, Alexander the Great, his big accomplishment as he conquered so much of the world, including Israel, was to move the Greek culture into those territories that he conquered. The Greek language, the Greek gods, all of that stuff were brought in. And so even though at this point Rome rules where Greece used to rule, Roman culture had not yet had the same impact. For example, Latin, the Roman language, was not commonly spoke throughout the empire, at least not yet. Greek was still commonly spoken. And so there were many Jews that were very Greek-oriented in their culture, even though they're still Jews. And then, of course, there are other Jews that didn't want anything to do with that, and they were very, you know, traditional and old school and all the rest. Well, in the earliest days of the church, even though all these people are believers, even though they're all supposed to love each other, there's those rivalries. And the Greek-influenced Jews thought that the traditional Jews were biased against them. They weren't being fair when they were distributing, you know, the societal kind of welfare, community giving, and all the rest of it. And that is just something about the church of God, the family of God. It's not a good thing, but it's a reality, is that we still have our same old sin nature. Just because we're born again, that doesn't go away, not till we're in glory. And unfortunately, too many in the church can let the sin nature continue to override and influence lives in areas that need to be nailed to the cross. And one of those, of course, is with prejudice, bias, bigotry, and so forth. And so that's what was going on in the early church. Now, I say that because you can imagine, we fast forward, and now the Gentiles out there somewhere, far away from Israel, the Gentiles are becoming believers in Jesus Christ, the Jewish Messiah. And Paul's the reason it's happening. Now, James and the other elders, I mean, they're very mature people, obviously. They rejoice to hear about what God's doing among the Gentiles. But you just know that you got a large number of Jewish Christians there in Jerusalem, and some of them aren't happy about these Gentiles being involved, and therefore they're not that happy with Paul. There's almost like a jealousy there. And so when there is that kind of an attitude, when there's a negative feeling towards someone who's not around typically, because Paul's traveling all over the world, well, you can imagine how easy it is for rumors and slander to get started, or for people to take something that, well, here's the truth, and then they mix it up, and now they're saying this. So again, once more, they've been informed that you're going around teaching the Jews who are among the Gentiles to forsake Moses and say that they ought not to circumcise their children and all the rest of it. We don't see Paul doing that. But Paul is, without any doubt or hesitation, clearly telling Jew and Gentile alike, don't think that any of that stuff gets you righteous before God. Paul, writing the Philippians, would emphasize the fact, hey, you know, I'm a Pharisee of the Pharisees. I'm a Jew. I'm a son of Abraham, tribe of Benjamin. And he goes on to talk about all of his Jewish pedigree, how circumcised the 8th day, all this. And he says, but what I might have seen as gain in the past, I count it all as just garbage, just trash, refuse to be found in Christ. None of it adds a thing to me. So if anyone thinks, hey, I've got a great Jewish pedigree or whatever, Paul says, hey, I much more. And yet, big deal. So, here's the challenge, though. He's in Jerusalem. And so they come up with kind of a solution, verse 23, to kind of calm the waters, so to speak, right? Therefore, do what we tell you. We have 4 men who have taken a vow. Take them and be purified with them and pay their expenses so that they may shave their heads and that all may know that those things of which they were informed concerning you are nothing, but that you yourself also walk orderly and keep the law. Concerning the Gentiles who believe, we've already written and decided that they should observe no such thing, except they keep themselves from things offered to idols, from blood, from things strangled, and from sexual immorality, which is exactly what the Jerusalem Council in Acts chapter 15 concluded concerning the Gentiles. And once more, not, you know, do this in order to get saved, but for the reasons of love and association and community and all the rest of it. We taught all that before. I won't teach it all now. Now, what's going on here, though? What a weird couple of verses there, right? 4 men who have taken a vow, take them, be purified with them, pay their expenses so they may shave their heads. And, you know, that'll convince everybody else that you're okay, Paul. This is a reference to the Nazarite vow, as it was called, which was something under the law of Moses that was voluntary, and you didn't have to do this, but if you wanted to make a special vow of commitment and consecration to the Lord, you would do this Nazarite vow. And of course, taking a vow to God, he didn't demand that, but if you did it, you better keep it and be serious about it. And so it wouldn't be like for the rest of your life, but it would be for a season of time. And during that time that you had the Nazarite vow in force, while it was going on, you didn't cut your hair. You just let it grow as long as it would grow. And then when the Nazarite vow was over, you would cut your hair. And you would typically, like in a symbolic kind of offering, you'd burn the hair and so forth. But if you read about the Nazarite vow, we won't take the time to turn there. It's in the book of Numbers, I believe chapter 6. You will find that associated with the conclusion of the Nazarite vow are different animal sacrifices and offerings and so forth. Well, you can imagine a bunch of animal sacrifices, especially someone who's just had this Nazarite vow, that's going to cost some money. And so what's being asked of Paul here is, we got these four guys that are just about to conclude their Nazarite vow, which means they're going to have to offer all these sacrifices. Why don't you sponsor them, Paul? Why don't you pay their expenses? That's their expenses, the idea of, why don't you buy the animals that they'll need for the sacrifices and all? And that will just show that you're still faithful to the law and you're a good guy and all the rest of it. You know, most people are not going to spend money on something that they absolutely reject and don't believe in at all, right? You know, how many non-Christians, for example, sponsor Christian missionaries or Bible translations and so forth, right? It just doesn't happen. And, you know, the church does those sort of things. And so if someone is going to come here and he's actually going to spend money so these guys have what is needed to complete their Nazarite vow under the law, then he obviously must be on our side, so to speak. That's the mindset that's going on here. They're making it very clear. We're not saying anything about what the Gentiles do or any of that. We're not changing what we decided at the council. And so Paul, verse 26, he took the men, and the next day, having been purified with them, entered the temple to announce the expiration of the days of purification, at which time an offering should be made for each one of them. So he goes ahead and does it. Now, I think it's a fair question to ponder, Paul, why did you do that? You know, why would you kind of give these people even an inch in their attitudes? Because it goes against, in so many ways, what you really believe in your heart. Again, there's nothing wrong with taking a Nazarite vow, nothing wrong with a Jew doing these things, but it's like this whole reason why you're doing it. You know, you can almost imagine, if you're Paul, that you'd almost be insulted a little bit. Now, Paul, we got a problem because we've got some believers down there. You know, you feel like, well, who cares about what those believers think? They're wrong. I didn't say that. I'm not doing that. And you know, you just kind of get upset a little bit. Or is that just me? But Paul does it. He's like, all right, okay, we'll do that. And we see he goes through with it. And the answer, I believe, can be explained for us in 1 Corinthians 9. Why don't you keep your finger in Acts, but turn to 1 Corinthians 9 with me to look at a few verses. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. Because at the heart of the answer is that Paul was always missionary-minded, missionary-focused, always wanting to advance the cause of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That was his life completely, wasn't it? And so in 1 Corinthians 9, when Paul is writing to the church at Corinth, he explains a little bit about his philosophy, how it shows itself in action. And I believe there is a lot that we can learn and apply in our lives to this mindset. Now, Paul, of course, is running into Jews a lot, but also the Gentiles. So that's like his main kind of contrast here. But for us, it might be someone else. So, verse 19 of chapter 9 of 1 Corinthians, Paul writes, "For though I am free from all men, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win the more." And what he means by that, he goes on, "To the Jews I became as a Jew, so that I might win Jews. To those who are under the law, as under the law, so that I might win those who are under the law." See, that's his motive. I want to see, you know, children of Abraham, the Jews, I want to see them come to saving faith in Jesus Christ. And we, I cannot express strongly enough the hatred that existed between the Jews against the Gentiles in those days. And so Paul says, so I'm going to associate, I'm going to align myself, if you will, to the Jews, and therefore I am going to act that way. You know, I became as a Jew. Well, he was a Jew, but he means how I lived. So you can imagine, if it's mealtime, he's going to eat kosher. Good, simple example. We just saw another example in Acts, you see, about him, I'm becoming like a Jew, I'm to those under the law. Why? For the gospel's sake, for Jesus' sake. But then the contrast, look at verse 21, to those who are without law, that would be like the Gentiles. The law of the law of Moses didn't mean anything to the Gentiles, so that's the idea of without law. He says, to those who are without law, as without law. Oh, but this is important. Then he adds, not being without law toward God, but under law towards Christ. And then he goes on to say, so that I might win those who are without the law of Moses. Now notice that. In other words, he's saying very clearly, hey, just because I'm with a bunch of Gentiles, and those Gentiles see nothing wrong with drunkenness, for example, just one example. You know, they praise the gods of wine. And Paul's trying to win those Gentiles to Christ. He's saying, that doesn't mean just because they don't care. You see, the Jews, would public drunkenness was a great sin in Israel. But, you know, Gentiles, that was like a daily occurrence in their lives. There was nothing to think about that at all. So Paul's not saying, hey, even though I'm with a bunch of these Gentiles, and they may think it's no big deal to get drunk every night, Paul says, I'm not saying I did that. So even though I'm not under, you know, they're not under the law of Moses, so I'm not living like I'm under the law of Moses, but I'm always still under Christ. I'm always still going to do the things that Christ wants me to do. So, you know, this mindset, and I hear every now and then, so I'm like, well, you know, my buddies and all, you know, have a few drinks and everything, and I want to be like them because I'm going to win them to Christ. So, you know, and no, we have to still be distinct because we're still servants of the Lord. Now, just as Jesus showed, that doesn't mean you don't go over at all. Hey, man, come on over. We're going to watch the game. Will there be alcohol there? Because I cannot be in a room. You know, you don't have to go like that, but that doesn't mean you have to participate. See, when Jesus walked the earth, always remember, the Bible tells us very clearly, and he got in trouble for this by his enemies. He went in to eat with the horrible sinners of a village, the drunkards, the tax collectors, the prostitutes. He went in and he had a meal with these people. And of course, in the first century, the culture, having a meal with somebody was a big deal. It was like a oneness, a fellowship. You don't want to be eating with these people. But when Jesus went into those dinners, one, he didn't participate in those kind of sins, and he changed the room by his presence. Jesus changed the room when he was in there. And as Christians, we should change the room. That doesn't mean, like, you know, while the game-winning field goal is about to be kicked in the game you're watching, he said, now wait a minute, I got to preach to you guys for a minute. You know, no, that's not changing the room. But one's mere presence, that you're bringing Christ in there, and you're still who you were in many ways before. You can still be a friend, you still maybe have a sense of humor or whatever, all those kind of things, but No, I don't drink anymore. No, I don't do that stuff anymore. No, how about the language? Those kind of things that come out of one's mouth. So, you see, that's what Paul's getting at. Hey, if I'm with a bunch of Gentiles, I'm just going to be like them. I'm not, when they offer me something to eat, I'm not going to say, I'm sorry, I eat kosher, I can't eat that. He said, no, I'll eat what everybody else is eating. Because eating and drinking doesn't make you more or less righteous before God. And I'm trying to win them. I'm not trying to say, well, you know, if you want to follow Jesus, you can't eat this stuff, or because that's not true. And I don't want to be weird. You know, there's nothing in the Bible that says Christians are to be weird in that sense of not sort of looking and being like the normalcy of a society in which you are in. Now, I got to caution that because obviously there's all sorts of levels in a society in terms of like how you dress and all that kind of stuff. But I do not believe that Christians should be walking around dressed like, you know, the pilgrims did when they got off the Mayflower or something, you know, because that's somehow holy dress. I just don't buy that at all. And by the way, you all pass my judgment. No. I mean, people would be scandalized at you. That's the guy preaching? I mean, what's he doing? He's wearing blue jeans and a shirt. Yeah. And so that aspect is where, hey, we're just like you, but then, oh, how we're different. So different. And you see, deep down, people who don't know the Lord, they know they're missing something. They know. I mean, they may kind of cover it, and there may be a lot of hostility, but and sometimes all you're doing is planting a seed. Sometimes it may be as simple as someone says, you know, I remember a few years ago I was at that party at the game and there was a Christian that was there. I didn't know who he was, but he was a friend of somebody else. And, well, I remember, you know, that guy impressed me. That lady really impressed me. And you know what? That seed was planted. You never see him again. They don't see you again or whatever. But the idea, because think about, speaking of culture, how are Christians today portrayed in just about every movie or television show out there? They're all portrayed either as a bunch of hypocrites who are secretly doing all sorts of sins and so forth, or they're portrayed as a bunch of bigots, or they're portrayed as just, you know, holier than thou, self-righteous. All of the portrayals that you see of Christians today in media, that's being watched by millions of people. And I've heard this said by some people in the industry. The simple fact is that the writers and the directors and the producers and so forth who write the scripts, almost always they don't personally know someone who's just walking with the Lord in the Spirit. They don't know personally what a Christian looks like. It's just a stereotype. It's just an imagination. And the stereotype just repeats itself and builds on itself over and over again, because again, that's the presentation and so forth. They don't know, just regular, average, God-fearing people living their lives, helping their neighbor, working their work, and they just don't know those people exist. And so when they actually come in contact with a real live specimen, and they actually, you know, have a conversation or two for an hour, or they see, and they think, oh, that guy's all right. Yeah. And then maybe they realize, you know, I'm not getting any satisfaction from the party scene and, you know, all the rest of it. Maybe I need a little God in my life. Maybe there's something missing. So Paul was like, hey, I want to win everybody, but I'm still going to stay faithful to Christ above all. And he goes on to talk about this. Verse 22, just to finish it up. To the weak I became as weak, that I might win the weak. Those weak in the faith says, I can't do that, can I? He's like, yeah, I won't do it either. I have become all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. Now this I do for the gospel's sake, that I may be partaker of it with you. And that's the key. Why is he doing it? For the gospel's sake. So going back to Acts, and you can turn back there again, he's not honoring, if you will, their misguided beliefs or their prejudices or any such thing. He's doing it for the gospel's sake. He's doing it as unto Jesus. That's the key. So, we are at verse 27. Now, when the 7 days were almost ended, the Jews from Asia, these are the Jews. They're not like locals in Jerusalem there. These are Jews that Paul has no doubt, maybe some of them actually specifically the same guys, but they know of Paul from his missionary journeys. Because remember, Paul would go into the synagogue first and preach the gospel in the synagogue to the Jews. And we saw that typically when he'd go to a synagogue, it was a mixed result. There would be some who might believe, but others who did not believe, they got angry. Then they got jealous because they lost, half the synagogue because all these Jews became believers, and so they took it out on Paul. And so we've seen in prior chapters how Paul was beaten, persecuted, even stoned to the point of what they thought was death to drag him out of the city by those who hated him. And so these guys show up at Jerusalem. It's the festival. They want to be there. There's that Paul guy. I remember him, out in Thessalonica or whatever. And so they saw him in the temple, and they stirred up the whole crowd, and they laid hands on him. They're crying out, "Men of Israel, help! This is the man who teaches all men everywhere against the people, the law, and this place," meaning the temple. "And furthermore, he also brought Greeks into the temple, Gentiles into the temple. He's defiled this holy place." And then Luke explains for us what that's all about, verse 29. "For they had previously seen Trophimus, the Ephesian, with him in the city, whom they supposed that Paul had brought into the temple." Now, just take a second on that. Now, just think of that. So Paul's standing with this Gentile, and they're talking or whatever. And these guys jump to the conclusion that he must have brought him into the temple. Isn't that amazing how people make these wild accusations and conclusions? Well, he must have. No, there's no mention of that. They just are imagining it because they hate him. And boy, when you hate somebody, you're willing to accept and imagine the craziest things. You see that sometimes in politics. There's so much hatred towards an individual, and someone will come up with an accusation, and all the people who hate that individual are like, "Yeah, I'm sure he did that." Because why not? He's a monster. And that's how they felt of Paul. So anything goes. Now, understand, and we kind of touched on this on Sundays when we were going through Mark a couple weeks ago, but real quick review. The way the temple in Jerusalem was situated was such that the temple itself, the actual building, the priests could go in and out, and only the priests. And of course, the Holy of Holies in the inner part of the temple, only the high priest once a year. So the priest ministered in their area. And then, a little further out, that's where the Jewish men would come to worship and to pray. A little further out, the Jewish women. There was a separation between Jewish men and Jewish women. And then, finally further out, was where the Gentiles could go. Gentiles who wanted to worship the God of Israel. The Jews allowed that. God allowed it. But they were very strict about the boundary. I mean, there was even a sign. This is noted in history and archaeology and everything. The idea that any Gentile who goes beyond this point forfeits his life. It's like a death penalty if you Gentiles, no matter how much you love God and serve God, if you go beyond that wall, if you enter into the Jewish area, then all bets are off and we can actually murder you, a capital crime. So that's the accusation here. So Paul's friends with a Gentile here, this Ephesian guy, and they just assume he brought him in to the Jewish area. Then, of course, he would. And Paul wouldn't do that. Again, we just read in 1 Corinthians 9. Why would he upset the Jews for no purpose and no reason for doing that? And let me add this. The reason, now, God didn't in the law of Moses, though he allowed Gentiles by all means to worship, but those divisions, those were not necessarily scriptural. But the temple was certainly scriptural. Only the priest could go into the temple. God was very clear about that. And only the high priest, like I said, in the Holy of Holies once a year on Yom Kippur. God was making it clear to his people all the way back to the days of Moses that approaching God was a very serious thing. You can just rush into the presence of God because he's holy and we're sinful. And so the priests only could approach God. The priest could approach God on your behalf. But only after you've had this sacrifice and this offering and blood was spilled according to the law. Without the shedding of blood, there can be no remission of sins. And so it was a big deal to approach God. Why? Because God is trying to remind his people he's holy and we're not. But all of that was put aside by Jesus Christ. All those animal sacrifices under the law of Moses, we realize were just foreshadowing of the sacrifice that Jesus would give, the Lamb of God, when he shed his blood. And you never see the early church. In fact, very early on in church history, Peter and John were told they're going to the temple to pray. Well, there's nothing wrong with praying at the temple still while it was still standing. But we never see anyone actually going with another animal sacrifice. They knew those days are over. It's okay to pray to God at the temple if you're in Jerusalem, but you don't bring animal sacrifices anymore. And of course, it wouldn't be much longer till the temple would be destroyed. And one hasn't been rebuilt since. 70 AD was when that temple in Jerusalem was destroyed. But you see, the New Testament makes it very clear. And by the way, this was written when the temple in Jerusalem was still standing, interestingly enough. But we're reminded that you, church, are the temple of God. Because what was the point of the temple in the first place? The point of the temple is God says, this is going to be a special dwelling place for me. Now, God fills the universe, we know that. But God said, in a very special way, I will dwell among my people in the temple. That's the whole point. But you see, those are the days that are gone because now we are the temple of God. Why would God use that phrase to describe us, that term? Because God dwells within you in a very special way through the Holy Spirit. You know, it's interesting, sometimes in the world you'll hear some guy, maybe a very athletic, fitness, my body is my temple. Well, that's the problem. Your body is your temple. No, biblically, our bodies are the temple of God. They're God's temple, not our own. We're not our own anymore. And that's elsewhere enforced in Paul's writings when he talks about defiling your bodies. You know, you're joining God with idols and horrible things. You don't do that. You know, what do you mean I'm joining God with it? Well, don't you know that, you know, you're the temple of God? God dwells within you. You're not your own. And so, that's what's going on here with the divisions and all that, because the temple was still standing in Jerusalem. And so these guys give this false accusation against Paul and are going to start a frenzy, a mob. So verse 30. Now remember, you got all these Jews around the temple area in Jerusalem. They're not all believers in Jesus Christ. I mean, the believers are still a minority, even though the church was large, relatively speaking. The Jews in Jerusalem at this time are still mostly non-Christians. So they hear that. Verse 30, all the city was disturbed and the people ran together. They seized Paul, dragged him out of the temple, and immediately the doors were shut. Now as they were seeking to kill him, news came to the commander of the garrison that all Jerusalem was in an uproar. And so he immediately took soldiers and centurions. So this is the Roman guy who's in charge, right? And he ran down to them. And when they saw the commander and the soldiers, they stopped beating Paul. So they were grabbing Paul, who, by the way, at this point, now we can't say exactly how old he was, but he was at least my age, and I'm going to be 56 this summer, or maybe a few years older. And so you got this big crowd beating up on an older guy, and they're wailing on him. But now, when all these Roman soldiers come in, they go, oh, we better stop, right? And so, cowards that they are, they stop beating on him once these guys show up. One thing I want to add before we continue on and finish the chapter. Back at verse 30, they dragged him out of the temple, and notice it says, and immediately the doors were shut. A lot of commentators on the book of Acts have noted and make a big deal about that verse, and I agree with them, so I'm just letting you know it's not original with me. I've read it, but boy, it sounds good. This is the last occurrence about the temple at this, in Acts. And, you know, the temple is such a big deal throughout the Gospels. It's a big deal in the book of Acts in some ways. And here's the last of it. When they're kicking Paul out and the doors are closed, it's like, God's like, this temple stuff is over. It's done. And this is the last example. These Jews, in what they think is their faithfulness to the temple, are actually kicking out the most devoted guy to God that there is walking the earth at that time, Paul. I mean, no one was better. What an irony. And so, that's it for the temple. And we're going to see, I mean, Paul might reference the temple at some point, but we're not going to see, you know, all the actions at the temple right now, and we've seen it before. No more. It's not going to be the setting for anything. So these guys show up, these Roman soldiers. The crowd stops wailing on Paul in verse 33. Then the commander came near and took him and commanded him to be bound with two chains. They're binding Paul. He's the one getting beat up. And he asked who he was and what he had done. Isn't that amazing? I mean, the guy who's getting beat up by the mobs, and what did he do? As if it justifies their violence towards him or something. You know, he must have done something wrong or they wouldn't be beating up on him. So some among the multitude cried one thing and some another. That's also typical of a mob scene, isn't it? They don't even know why they're doing it. It's just, let me just join in. I'll get a few punches in, right? So when he could not ascertain the truth because of the tumult, he commanded him, Paul, to be taken into the barracks. And when he reached the stairs, he had to be carried by the soldiers because of the violence of the mob. For the multitude of the people followed after, and they were crying out, "Away with him!" Now that should ring echoes of another Jew years earlier that a riotous mob in Jerusalem were crying out, "Away with him!" to Jesus, of course. "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" And boy, they would have loved to see Paul crucified right there on the spot if they had the power. You know it. So, verse 37, as we wrap this up, then as Paul was about to be led into the barracks, he said to the commander, the Roman commander, he said, "May I speak to you?" And he replied, "Can you speak Greek?" Because that's what Paul spoke to him. And of course, Paul could speak Greek. But then look at verse 38. "Are you not the Egyptian who some time ago stirred up a rebellion and led the 4,000 assassins out into the wilderness?" Now you're thinking, like, what is that all about? This isn't in the Bible, but it's recorded in history that about 3 years before this event, there was an Egyptian guy. Now, you know, Egyptian, you might think of, you know, people from Egypt today or whatever, but a lot of Jews lived in Egypt. And so he's a Jew, but he's an Egyptian Jew. And so this guy had organized a rebellion of Jews and were planning to march on Jerusalem and overthrow Rome. And again, history records this. It's about 3 years or so before this event. And the thing what happened is, of course, Rome put down the attempt, didn't really get too far, and of course, hundreds of the people that were involved were arrested, many were killed, but the leader, that Egyptian guy, he escaped. So he's still out there somewhere. So now they're seeing Paul and a big crowd, and he said, aren't you that Egyptian guy? And that's what he's referencing to, right? Of course, Paul's like, no. Also, once more, Egyptian Jews would definitely have spoken Greek. So when Paul said, hey, can I talk to you for a moment? And he did it in the Greek language. That's why the guy's, this must be that Egyptian. You see how it all comes together? But of course, that's not who Paul is. So Paul answers in verse 39. Hey, I'm a Jew from Tarsus in Cilicia, a citizen of no average city. In other words, Tarsus is a pretty important city. It's pretty well known by people and so forth. You know, that's not some average, you know, backwater place. Or, hey, I'm a citizen of no average city, and I implore you, permit me to speak to the people. So when he had given him permission, Paul stood on the stairs and motioned with his hand to the people. And when there was a great silence, he spoke to them in the Hebrew language. So he's not going to speak Greek. He's speaking the Hebrew language, which, by the way, was Aramaic, because like what we think of as typically Hebrew in those days had become much more of a scholarly, written kind of language. The average people spoke Aramaic, not Arabic, Aramaic. So that's what's going on here. But he's going to address the crowd of Jews from a safe perch by the commander there, because they had just, of course, gone up the stairs and everything. Verse 35 had told us that. And so they all got silent to hear what he was going to say. And he begins, and we stop there. Because the chapter stops there. You know, not my fault. But I know it's one of those chapter divisions. I guess they figured like chapter 21 was long enough. If we include everything that Paul says, this is going to be a massive chapter, and it's just too long for it. And, you know, when they start teaching the Bible, they're going to, you know, have a long message. So anyway, we'll pick it up next Wednesday, though. And we'll see what exactly Paul says to the crowd of Jews there who hate his guts, but he's trying to share. And again, remember what we said, ministry focus, the gospel of Jesus Christ. That was Paul's heart, and we'll see that. So let's pray. Lord, thank you again for this time in your word and the time we've had today worshiping you in spirit and truth. Help us, Lord, when people have false ideas about us, maybe falsely accuse us of things, misunderstand us, don't know even really who we are as followers of you, Lord. Help us to bear witness to the truth, bear witness to you, Lord, through our lives, and Lord, that we might see others come to know you, and Lord, that you might be glorified through it all. Bless us as we dismiss now. Watch over us on our drives back to our homes, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.